Welcome, everybody. I'm Noah Schultz-Bayard, the essay director at the Australia Institute. I'm filling in for Ebony Bennett, the Australia Institute's deputy director and the usual host of our webinar series. Ebony has passed hosting duties for these webinars over to me for the next little while as she takes a well-earned break. And before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge that I'm coming to you today from the land of the Kaurna people on the Adelaide Plains, and acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet. The sovereignty was never ceded, and I pay my respects to elders past and present. So, just a few tips to help things run smoothly today. If you hover your mouse pointer over the bottom of your screen, you should be able to see a Q&A function where you can ask questions of our panel and upvote questions from other attendees. There's also a chat function. We ask that you please keep your comments civil and on topic in the chat. Basically, can we all just be nice to each other for an hour on the internet? And we have the capacity to boot out people who aren't being nice, so keep it friendly. A few people have said that they find the notifications that pop up from the comment thread a little distracting. You should be able to click on it, pop that window out and move it to the side of the screen where it will hopefully be less distracting. But we do really value the conversation that happens in these webinars and the back and forth. So thank you to everyone who contributes to these discussions. This session is being recorded and we post these sessions on our website after they're completed, but we also email out a copy of it to everyone who signed up as an attendee. Finally, the Australia Institute is aiming to host these webinars at least weekly, but the days and the times of day that we host them does change a little bit from week to week. So to make sure you don't miss out, the easiest thing to do is to subscribe at our website, which is tai.org.au/webinars. Sign up there and you won't miss any one of these fantastic discussions. So, thank you all for being with us here today for what is the third session of our Economics Academy series. In the series so far, over the last few episodes, we've discussed a range of economic concepts from opportunity costs to thinking at the margins and talked about the essence of economics and how it's technically the science of efficient allocation of scarce resources. Today, in this third session of the Academy, we'll be talking about the laws of supply and demand and putting a special lens on the issues of supply and demand when it comes to living through a national crisis. Joining me to unpack the econobabble today is the Australia Institute's chief economist, Richard Dennis, and our senior economist, Matt Grudenoff. Thank you both for being with us today. On the issues of supply and demand, we covered the technical definitions of those words in the homework video that was sent to all attendees a few days ago. Hopefully, you've all had a chance to watch that video in preparation for today. We are going to dig a little bit deeper into those concepts and specifically how COVID-19 has affected those issues in Australia. But just before we begin on that, Richard, I might ask if you could give a very brief overview of supply and demand. I ask because lay people such as myself, we feel like, oh yeah, we've got a bit of an idea of what that is. And you can also just drop it into conversations and it makes you sound kind of smart. But what does it actually mean when we're talking about supply and demand from an economic point?
Thanks, Noah. And you know, what a polite way to, you know, get things started for those that haven't done their homework yet. But yeah, we hear about supply and demand all the time. You even hear about the forces of supply and demand, and it sounds very sciencey. You know, it sounds very like natural laws sort of shaping things. But of course, when we're talking about demand, what we're talking about is people's, humans, individuals' willingness and ability to pay for something. So the demand for Coca-Cola or the demand for petrol or the demand for a concert ticket is really just the sum, the total of all the humans who feel like spending money to buy something and have got that much money in their pocket. So before we move on to supply, the key thing to know about demand is it's not want and it's not need, it's willingness and ability. And that means you've got the cash and you want to spend it. So homeless people don't have demand for housing, which is different from don't have a need for housing or a desire for housing or a want for housing. If you don't have the cash in your pocket to back up your preferences, from an economist's point of view, you're not expressing demand. You're not waving money around saying, hey, I've got money, who wants to give me something? So demand is the sum of all the people who are willing and able to buy something, and supply just refers to, again, the total of all the people who have the capacity to produce something, the capacity to supply something. So whether it's potatoes or mobile phone towers, people will produce something if they can see there's demand for it and they think they can make something cheaper than you're willing to pay for it. And the forces of supply and demand coming together is just humans that want something and humans that make something coming together to trade. That's what we're talking about.
Yeah, right. So it looks like we may have just lost Matt temporarily. Either his video's turned off.
We don't know.
Good.
I've been carrying him.
Good. We'll soldier on. Hopefully we'll have his company back in a little bit. But, you know, those issues of supply and demand, they're fascinating in isolation. But in the real world, they tend to get a bit buffeted and knocked around by what's actually happening. A major example of that for us this year, of course, has been the COVID-19 pandemic. So could you talk us through a little bit about how supply and demand and the market in Australia, because most goods in Australia are delivered via a market, how supply and demand handled this huge upheaval we've gone through?
Yeah, exactly. So let's think about, you know, the first big shock that came from coronavirus. We might have forgotten now, but it was big news at the time. At the beginning of the crisis, the biggest economic event was the shortage of toilet paper. Right? Now, what happened? Where did all the toilet paper go? Well,
it wasn't me, I promise.
You were late to the party, huh? So, yeah. So the shortage, what we've noticed as a shortage, the lack of toilet paper on the shelves, was actually caused by a surge in demand. Now, again, remember, demand isn't a thing. It's the sum of all of our individual actions. So what happened was millions of people thought, oh, I wouldn't want to get through a pandemic and run out of bog roll. So I might stockpile some. You know, for whatever reason, people decided that the worst thing to run out of might be toilet paper. So that led to an increase in demand. And the people that make the toilet paper, the people that supply the toilet paper, couldn't ramp up their capacity very quickly. And even after they ramped up the capacity, they actually had trouble kind of stuffing it into enough trucks, because toilet paper takes up a lot of room in the trucks. So yeah, so at the very beginning of this crisis, we saw a surge in demand for toilet paper. Now, the supply ultimately caught up, but in between, there was a shortage. Now, two things can happen when there's a shortage. In a market system, economists would say the efficient thing to do when things are scarce is jack up the price. But you'll notice that nearly all of the stores were very reluctant to do that. They didn't want to be accused of price gouging or ripping people off. But of course, whenever something's in short supply in Australia, whether it's waterfront homes or lobsters or concert tickets, the price goes up. So the reason we were running out of toilet paper was that the shops didn't really want to let market forces do their thing, because they thought they'd get in so much trouble, it just wasn't worth it. And that's why we ran out. But another good example was hand sanitizer. Again, everyone rushed out to buy stuff and were being told to. It was a good idea. But, you know, the people that make hand sanitizer, well, they didn't know. Right, so they would just be busy making their hand sanitizer and pumping it out to shops, and all of a sudden everyone shows up and wanted the hand sanitizer. Now, again, it took a little while, like the toilet paper, but you know, we saw a classic example of the efficiency of a market here, where a bunch of producers that didn't usually make hand sanitizer, including distilleries, went, hang on, there's a lot of demand for hand sanitizer. I know how to make gin. That's what I usually make. but I can use the equipment I've got and the skill I've got to make this other product. And that's a classic example of why economists generally like markets, because when all of the extra demand showed up, we saw how the price and the profits from selling hand sanitizer led to a bunch of new suppliers showing up. And yeah, that's the efficiency of markets.
Right. I see we've got Matt back here. Great to have you back, Matt. We only said very nice things about you while you're gone, I can promise. We were just talking there about an example of supply and demand working in a sense when it came to creating more hand sanitizer, but there were a range of shocks to the economy from COVID that are still having a lasting impact. And it would probably be pretty hard to explain to Alan Joyce right now that everything's working perfectly and everything's recalibrating. It kind of, the difficulty that airlines are in currently, does this go to show some of the limitations of supply and demand? In the tutorial video, we had very clear trend lines for how supply works and how demand works. You get the cross section, but it's not quite that simple in reality. And there are real limitations to this, aren't there?
Yeah, look, absolutely. And what Qantas and other airlines are facing is two things. Firstly, you know, government saying, well, you can't fly, you know, that flying is unsafe. And so, you know, except under special sort of limited circumstances, you know, we're going to massively reduce how much of the good you can actually supply to the market. And at the other end, even if there was no sort of regulatory stopping of this sort of thing, what we would actually see is probably some very, very nervous consumers. That is, demand for the good would collapse because people don't want to be stuck on, you know, a sort of compressed tube of, you know, sharing sort of air with a heap of other people they don't know and possibly sort of contracting COVID. So either supply collapses in part because of restrictions that the government imposes or we see a demand collapse in the form of customers just not feeling safe using the product. And consequently, you know, it becomes very difficult to make a profit in that kind of industry at that time.
Yeah, and also add to that, like, remember that usually, like, let's use the language of free markets. In a free market, if demand for something dries up, if people don't want to rent videos anymore, or they don't want to get photographic film developed anymore, companies go broke. Like, that's the point. You know, if people don't want to buy something, there's no point producing it. Where reality kicks in and where our sense of community kicks in, but also where our sense of the long term kicks in, is that, you know, you could argue from an economic point of view, if people can't fly and the airlines go broke, oh, well, that's okay, no worries. If people don't want to buy something, we shouldn't supply it. But there's a couple of problems with kind of letting that logic play out. One is nearly everyone thinks, but on the other side of this, we're going to want airlines again. And airlines are hard to set up from scratch. So we don't really want the market to send the airlines broke, because no one actually imagines that in a year or two's time, we don't want airlines. And at the same time in Australia, we're trying to keep people in jobs. So again, if the airlines go broke, a bunch of people lose their jobs. And when things pick up, it might take years instead of months to get the airline industry and all those employees working in aviation again. So in theory, if there's no demand for something, there shouldn't be any supply for it. Companies should go broke. You know, that's why there aren't many people out there these days manufacturing and selling cod pieces or, you know, Renaissance wigs. No, well, once upon a time, that was a big thing and people spent a lot of money on them, not anymore. Well, when we stop buying stuff, it makes sense to stop producing stuff. This is something the coal industry and the gas industry don't like to hear, but this is economics 101. But sometimes, and we can argue about when, but sometimes we don't want to see supply disappear when demand dips, especially if we imagine that we're going to want that supply again at some point in the near future.
Mm-hmm. Matt, I might ask you, we talked a little bit before, I'm not sure if it was while you were in the room, about what one of the responses to the toilet paper shortage of COVID could have been, and that could have been jacking the price up through the roof. And from the video that we showed as homework for this session, that would have effectively been trying to find the point of equilibrium, on those graphs. Basically, you want to set the price point where the amount of toilet paper you have meets the willingness of people to pay. So the shop runs out of toilet paper at 5 p.m. instead of, you know, 7 in the morning. But that would see the cost of toilet paper go up to $100 a roll. What's wrong with using equilibrium? I guess another way to ask it is, shouldn't we look for equilibrium? Isn't everyone happy once we've found the point of equilibrium?
Yeah, that's a really, really good question. And equilibrium is just what economists call the market clearing price. That's basically the price where the amount of people who want to supply and the amount of people who want to buy is exactly the same. So the exact all of the stuff gets sold, and there's no people who missed out, and there's no excess goods on the market. The problem with that is that that's not going to make everybody happy. There are plenty of people who would rather buy it at a lower price. And probably not in this example, but there'd probably be plenty of people who would want to supply it at a higher price. But we know that that's not where everybody's happy. That's just where supply is equal to demand. We don't have an excess and we don't have a shortage. And, you know, there are other things, like we can use markets to ration. And basically by using the equilibrium price, we're essentially deciding who gets it and who doesn't. And people who are willing to pay a really high price, who have a lot of money, are able to buy it. Those that don't can't. And in society, you know, we do fair. In economics, we don't do fair, but in society, we want to talk about fair. And we decide, well, you know, actually, just because you're rich or you have a lot of money doesn't mean you should get access to all of the toilet paper and everybody else should miss out. And so we create these other societal rules. We suspend economics. We say, no, you're about the efficient allocation of scarce resources. Right now, we want to talk about the fair allocation of scarce resources. So we're going to reject your way of allocating. We're not going to use a market. We're going to use other ways.
That's a good point. And thank you for bringing up the concept of fair. I wanted to ask a question of Richard. So society agreed we weren't going to tolerate sending the cost of hand sanitizer up to $100 for a small bottle, even if people were willing to pay for it. So why do we get outraged at the short-term spike in the price of something like toilet paper or hand sanitizer, but where we seem to be perfectly happy with a significant increase in the cost of housing over many decades that are pricing a lot of people out of the market? I have to say, in the interests of full disclosure, my partner and I are trying to buy our first home currently. We just had an offer on a house fall through this morning. So I'm very interested in that subject right now. And it's a motivated question.
Right. So you're a greedy, self-interested rent seeker.
I just want a house.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this is why it's so important. I think that, you know, we talk to so many people about what economics is and isn't, because we arbitrarily decide to step in and intervene in some markets and not others. So some things are so important that we want to make sure everyone gets access to them. So for example, no matter what your income or how sick you are, we'll give you life-saving drugs for $7, no matter how much it costs the government to buy them. So with a really important market like pharmaceuticals, we subsidize and cap the price because we don't want people rationing access to that medicine. We want them to take it. And then there's other really important markets that we obviously have to intervene in, like concert tickets. I mean, imagine if we let the market set the price of tickets for a Kylie Minogue concert. I mean, no, that's crazy, all right? So we step in and we ban scalpers buying tickets, and because it's so important that we intervene to prevent scalpers. Irony alert, people, I'm being sarcastic. But when it comes to housing, let it rip, okay? Or when it comes to fresh fruit and vegetables in Indigenous communities, who are we to intervene in the market? So it's entirely up to us. It's entirely up to us. And governments intervene in markets all the time. We spend a fortune subsidising private schools. We spend a fortune subsidising private hospitals. We have anti-scalping laws. We have all sorts of restrictions on price for all sorts of things, but all sorts of things isn't a clearly defined category. It's whatever some powerful groups or some politicians with a bee in their bonnet made happen, And for everyone listening, if we wanted to regulate a different market, we could. And if we wanted to remove restrictions from a market, we could. 194 countries in the world, guess what? We don't all agree which markets to intervene in. There's no right way to do it. And fair, as Matt said, isn't an economic concept. It's in the eye of the beholder.
Yeah, and look, well, as an economist, what scalping tells me is that the market price is too low. That, you know, right. Quite literally, people are walking in, they're getting in early in the queue, and they're on selling them at a higher price. They only can do that because the price is clearly too low.
If the price was set at an equilibrium point, the last ticket would sell as the concert was starting. Like someone would go to the box office at 1 minute before the concert starts and buys the very last ticket. But they sell, often big concerts will sell out in a minute or two. Why do you think that failure in the market is allowed to exist? What is the rationale behind not choosing not to meet equilibrium?
I think there's lots of explanations. I mean, in Australia, well, actually put it positively, in a country like America, pre-COVID, you could show up and buy a last-minute ticket to get on a plane, and it's pretty cheap. Right, so you're taking a risk, you might miss out, but they'll sell the last seat to you pretty quick. In Australia, that doesn't happen. You can't even book online 2 hours before the plane takes. So different countries, different companies, different cultures sort of evolve different notions of what's fair and what's reasonable. When it comes to concert tickets, let's be clear, if it's a popular concert, people are going to miss out. There's two ways you can miss out. We can let the market set price and low-income earners will miss out. Or we can let the time and queue set the price, and people that don't have a lot of time will miss out. So someone's going to miss out. That's the point. It's scarce. And we can use price to ration who gets access, or we can use long queues to ration who gets access. And for whatever reason, different people in different industries come up with different notions of fair. But I mean, to be cynical, I think concert promoters want to get the story out that the concert is a sellout. They want to get the story out that this is the cool band, that this is people that want to go to see. So it's actually in their interests to set the price low and sell out, because then everyone knows that's a cool artist. They might actually make more money setting the price higher and only selling 80% of the seats. But then, you know, on the night, people look around and think, oh, I paid a lot to come here and it's not even full. Mm. So you could argue that they deliberately set the price low to fill them up, and then they get the shits watching other people profit from the scalping. So, you know, we end up against scalping.
Speaking of big crowds and sellout theatres, we have 883 people in the audience currently, which I think is a pretty good turnout for three people sitting around talking economics.
I think we've got to jack the price up.
Right, zero is probably a bit low, you're thinking? So that's great. The questions are coming in. I can see here. We'll go to audience questions in a minute. One other area, though, to cover before we move on. Matt, could you quickly run through elastic goods, elasticity, and what the concept means?
Yeah, look, so we covered this in the video, but briefly, there are basically goods that are sensitive to changes in price, and they're goods with lots of substitutes. So if you imagine bananas, I think we use it as the example in the video, if the price of bananas goes up, then people are going to opt out of buying bananas, and they might buy apples, they might buy oranges, they might buy other kinds of fruit. That is, they're very sensitive to changes in the price of bananas. And there are other goods that are very insensitive to changes in prices. That is, if you put the price up a lot, people wouldn't reduce their consumption of it very much. And they're usually goods that are addictive or goods that we desperately need. So for example, insulin to a diabetic, all right, they're going to be very insensitive to changes in price. They're going to continue to pay if you put the price up, and they're not likely to change how much they consume based on price. And so we have a huge range of goods, from very inelastic goods, that is very insensitive to changes in price, all the way through to very elastic goods and everything in between.
And just on that, I mean, bananas is a great example. Allow me to sound like a heartless economist. I remember, there was a cyclone hit up north more than 10 years or so ago now, wiped out most of the banana supply in Australia, and the price of bananas went through the roof. and there was this, you know, bananas were $20 a kilogram, and everyone's, oh my God, bananas so expensive. Won't somebody do something? Most economists thought, buy an apple. You know, because there's so many substitutes for bananas, you know, when the supply got crushed, if everyone still wanted to buy them, well, guess what? There weren't enough bananas. We were using price to decide who got the bananas. And for me, as a citizen, as an economist, I reckon the stakes are pretty low. I think people showing up to get insulin and not finding their insulin is really quite different from showing up at Woolworths and thinking, oh, I wouldn't mind a banana, or that's a bit icky, I might buy an apple instead. So the fact that the price went up, again, for me, is a sign of a market working pretty efficiently. For the people out there that love nothing more in the world than having a banana smoothie, well, okay, prove that you really like banana smoothies so much by paying a high price. And if you can't be bothered paying it, great. Someone else gets the banana. They value it more. Mm. You know, but you, but as a citizen, as an economist, I don't take that logic and say, yeah, let's apply that to penicillin, or let's apply that to housing, or let's apply that to access to emergency care in a hospital. It's it's okay as citizens to want to step in to fix some problems, and others just to say, well, you know, fair enough, someone had to miss out, might as well be me.
You say that the banana choice is rather elastic. I've got a mate, I remember the banana shortage. I've got a mate who was obsessed with banana caramel pie, and I wasn't sure he was going to make it through that shortage. So it can be a pretty serious issue for some people.
I'm happy to see him be able to go to the shop and buy the bananas and me tap out. The other option, yes. No, because the only other option is first in, best dressed on the bananas. And your mate who loves them is more likely to miss out than get them. So again, once you understand someone's always going to miss out, once we accept that economics is all about scarcity and someone's going to miss out, we can have entirely different conversations about good, bad, fair, right, and wrong.
Matt, just before we go to questions from the audience, we've heard over the last few days that a number of Australia's closest trading partners, such as Japan, China, and South Korea, have announced zero carbon emissions targets for the coming decades. Do the laws of supply and demand hold in relation to international trade? And basically, should the government be worried if they're building an economic system that relies on a huge amount of demand for gas and coal that seems to be tapering away in the near future?
Yeah, look, it definitely does apply to internationally traded goods. And what we'll likely see as, you know, Japan and China and South Korea move away from coal and gas is we're going to see the price of these products go down. We'll see the demand curve shift. We'll see it decrease. And the price will fall, and it'll become harder and harder for those digging those fossil fuels up to be able to supply the market at the ever decreasing price. And, you know, much like, you know, the last person who was making horse and buggies, those buggies for horse and buggies, right, was probably the most efficient one, the last one that before they went broke. We'll probably see some of around the world, you know, the most efficient coal miners or the most efficient gas miners be the last ones to tap out, but they'll eventually tap out as technology changes, as we decide that, you know, we don't want to live in a warm, horrible environment, and we'll see the price fall below what we can actually supply the goods at. So yes, I think that this announcement really shows that you know, the government trying to encourage more investment and greater investment in coal and gas is a bad idea if demand internationally for those goods is falling.
And just on that, Richard, do the economic laws of supply and demand take into account little things like the human species' desire to remain on a livable planet? You know, we're going to make decisions, hopefully, that are based on the predictions of global warming over the decades. Is that factored into models of supply and demand?
No, not at all. What's factored in is willingness and ability to pay. So if there are enough people on the planet who are willing and able to keep buying oil or keep buying coal, as long as they're willing to hand over their cash, then a company is going to set up to supply to meet that need, unless we step in to say you can't. So once upon a time, there were people who were willing and able to buy whale meat, and there were people in Australia willing and able to go whaling. And we stepped in and went, yeah, no, not going to do that anymore. Did that cause unemployment amongst whalers? Yes. Did it affect regional communities? Yes. Did we do it anyway? Yes, because we collectively thought, I don't care that you're willing and able to pay and they're willing and able to do it. We collectively don't like the look of it. Mm. We did exactly the same thing with asbestos. There are people willing and able to produce asbestos. There are companies willing and able to buy it to make heat pads and brake pads and all sorts of things, and we step in. So, no, there's nothing in economics that says if something's a dumb idea, the market won't do it. There's nothing. All there is the willingness and ability to pay and the willingness and ability to supply. And if those two things line up, you would expect market exchange to take place unless we want to step in. And we step in all the time. Marijuana, heroin, cocaine, methamphetamines, asbestos, right? We step in whenever we don't like the outcome, except when it comes to coal, in which case it'd be crazy to step in, because who would ever intervene in a market?
That's a good segue to one of the questions from the audience that I'll ask. Matt, I'll throw this one to you, and it comes from Chelsea Reed. She says, there's been a lot of talk in this series about the amorality of economics. If economics is the language of policy and policy determines access to basic goods and services, we simply can't rely on a completely amoral discipline to drive distribution. How can we bring morality into economics? And by doing so, does economics lose its claim to an accepted scientific discipline?
Well, yeah, look, that's a very good question. And the answer is decisions shouldn't be made by economists. Decisions need to be made collectively. We need to decide how we're going to decide things. A lot of our decisions are made through democratic processes, through parliaments, through passing legislation. All that economics can do is advise, all right? All it can do is say, look, we have this tool bag that can tell you some interesting things about how you might want to allocate resources, how you might want to decide who misses out, how you might want to structure your economy. But the ultimate decision, as the question said, those tools are amoral in that they don't make judgments that need to be made. Those judgments need to be made, and they shouldn't be made by economists. So, you know, I mean, Richard and I spend an awful lot of time telling, as economists, going around telling people not to listen to economists all the time. And it's not that you shouldn't listen to economists at all. It's that you shouldn't assume that, you know, they are the final arbiters of what should and shouldn't happen. Rather, you know, we need to think, well, is this a situation where fairness is more important? Is this a situation where the long-term survival of the species is more important? Are these situations where we want to efficiently allocate scarce resources, or do we want to allocate them in other ways? Or do we want to take a bit of one and a bit of the other, in which case it's really the economist's job to provide options. It's an economist's job to create a larger menu of choices. And sometimes economics is actually used to do the exact opposite. It's designed to limit choices. It's about saying you must do it this way because that's the most economically efficient way. Quite the opposite. Economics should be giving us more options that we can choose or not choose. It's not about telling people what they must do. That's a collective decision. That's a democratic decision.
Yeah, I agree. And just to be clear, economists aren't in charge really of anything, right? People sort of say, oh, the problem is economists do this and economists do that. Well, Scott Morrison's not an economist. Josh Frydenberg's not an economist. Paul Keating wasn't an economist. Wayne Swan wasn't an economist. Kevin Rudd wasn't an economist. The idea that prime ministers sit in their room getting bullied into doing things by some big, bad economists is just ridiculous. As Matt said, it's the opposite. The terrible, brutal, horrible truth is that economists are used by powerful people to tell everybody else we have to do what the boss said. There is no choice. The boss said we have to have a free trade agreement with America. It's good for the economy. I'm here to econobabble at you until you stop asking questions. The boss said we have to cut taxes for his rich mates. I'm here to econobabble at you until you stop asking questions. The idea that it's the economists making powerful people do things is demonstrably untrue. but it actually helps conceal the reality of power to keep blaming economists. Because if we blame economics and blame economists, then the real decision makers actually avoid responsibility. It's genius.
Richard, you know, you're a hero of trying to unpack econobabble and remove that sort of...
It's niche market, isn't it?
Trying to remove the sort of the magic around the weapon that's used to bamboozle people. I'll go to you with a question about the reality and some of the limitations. Kathleen Davies asks, please could you explain more about the slope and direction of those supply and demand curves from the tutorial? Are these actually measured in reality, or is this just another example of economists suffering from physics and a physicist's envy?
Both. So let's take the demand curve first. We describe it as downward sloping to the right. And what it suggests is if the price is high, people won't buy much stuff. And if you drop the price, as the price falls, people will purchase more of something. Now, we call that the law of demand, and that is definitely physics envy. There is nothing lawy about this at all. It's a tendency. It happens a bit sometimes over the relevant range of prices. So let me give you an example. Sometimes when you put the price of something up, people buy more of it, right? Because they think it's better. They have no objective way to determine quality, so they think the dearer one is better. Now, I know that no one out there is sort of falls for this stuff. Like, I know that prestige and habit and culture has no impact on anyone watching today, but we've all got a dumb brother-in-law or someone that falls for this stuff. So, you know, here's the text. Next time you're at the shops, compare the price of a 2-litre bottle of Coke to the price of a 2-litre bottle of cola. You'll find the cola, no-name stuff, if you can even find it, is about 10% of the price. So buy yourself a nice big bottle of cola, and next time someone comes to your house, serve it to them. Right? I dare you to take it to a barbecue or a picnic. So selling cheap stuff can actually discourage demand for some products. There's no doubt about that. But at the same time, watch what happens at your petrol station if they go out and sell petrol for 80 cents a litre. There'll be a queue around the block. So the downward sloping demand curve doesn't happen all the time, but it often happens. The upward sloping supply curve, well, that's kind of fantasy era stuff, except when you understand that economics is a 200-year-old profession, and for agricultural production and for mineral extraction, you really do get that upward sloping supply curve. So if someone's going to grow potatoes, I reckon the first place they'll grow potatoes is in good soil, near good water, near to the market. And if people want to buy a lot more potatoes, the next crop you plant, the next crop gets further and further away from the best stuff. If someone's going to mine for gold, they mine the most fertile place first.
It's effectively what's happening with gas in Australia right now.
Absolutely. Now that we've succeeded in our plan to make gas expensive, we can now... No, that was the plan. Mission accomplished. We've made gas so expensive now, a whole bunch of gas that we used to ignore, it's now viable for the producers to try and suck it out. But not the upward sloping supply curve is a bit of a nightmare when it comes to mass production of something like this phone, whatever electronic device you're using. Trying to make one or two of these things is extraordinarily expensive. But if you make 100 million of them per unit, they get very, very cheap. So the upward sloping supply curve is pretty irrelevant for most manufactured goods. It's entirely irrelevant for information goods. Like if I make a television show, it doesn't matter how many times I show it, it doesn't get more expensive to make.
Or a webinar.
So it's useful to understand. It's not completely silly, but we'll have to do Economics Academy 202 to go into economies of scale in more detail.
See, great. All right. Next question I'll send your way, Matt. This comes from Michelle Smith. She asks, does the operation of supply and demand require that all costs are reflected in prices, in particular, that environmental externalities are internalized?
Yeah, look, that's a great question. And we'll actually cover that in a later episode, but I'd love to talk about it right now. Look, if you want, so economics, as we keep saying, is the efficient allocation of scarce resources. If you want it actually to be efficient, then you have to include all of the costs within the transaction. And that includes the externalities, which by their nature are not included in. So you have to capture them somehow. And the reason is if you don't, then if something has what's called a negative externality, that is, it's something that causes a problem for somebody else who's not part of the transaction. So pollution, for example, let's say I own a paint factory and rather than expensively disposing of my waste chemicals, I just dump them in the river next to my factory. Well, that impacts everybody who wants to use that river, right? But it doesn't impact me and it probably doesn't impact the people I'm selling my paint to. But what it means is I can sell my paint cheaper, which means I'm going to sell more paint and I'll have an overproduction basically of paint. All right. So what we need to do in that particular case is capture that negative externality within the transaction. That is, we need to force the paint company, my paint company, to dispose of that waste in a responsible way so that it doesn't impact negatively on other people. Now, that's actually going to increase the price of the paint. But then economists will say, well, that's the point. All right. The point is the paint should cost what should sell for what it actually costs to properly make, not be subsidized by people who happen to lose out because they're further down the river. And obviously climate change is another example. You know, if what we're producing is creating lots of greenhouse gases, that has a negative impact on everybody else on the planet. And if we're going to produce the efficient amount, the right amount, well, I won't say right, that's right or wrong, economists don't do that. If we're going to produce the efficient amount, then we need to include those negative externalities in the production process and in the final price of the good.
We've got a couple of questions here looking at and asking about modelling. Mathematical and economic modeling. James Bannon asks, demand and supply also assumes that market participants have perfect knowledge, so are aware of options and substitutions, for example. We know that participants, people, never have perfect knowledge in reality. How can economics incorporate this into their modeling? Richard, I'll throw this one to you.
Yeah, so there's lots of sort of assumptions that we make in economics to get from leaving it to the market, to get to the conclusion that if you just leave it to the market, we'll get the efficient outcome. We make a lot of assumptions. One of them, as the questioner asks, is perfect information. That is that the people buying the stuff are fully aware of all the choices, all the substitutes, and the relative prices and relative quality of all of them. And another is that we have what we call zero transaction costs. That if I want to change my mind, if I want to go to this shop instead of this one, I don't have to drive 10 kilometers further or anything else. So yeah, when we assume perfect information and zero transaction costs, it gets easy to think markets will work well. So imagine you're at a fruit market or a fish market, and you're deciding, you know, which fish to buy for dinner or what fruit to buy this week. You know, is there good information around? Yeah, there really is. Are the transaction costs low? Yes. Are the search costs low? Yes. So is a well-informed customer walking around a fruit market going to find the optimal combination for them? Yeah, I reckon so. But there's a reason we make petrol stations stick their price up at the front of the petrol station, because when you're driving along, by the time you pull up and stop, if you've got to look at that little font, a lot of people think, oh, stuff it, I've stopped now. So we often intervene in the market to try and make it easier, as opposed to perfectly easier for people to shop around. And we have the ACCC and other regulatory apparatus to prevent people deliberately misleading people, that is going out of their way to provide false information. But back to the questioner's original question, yes, if there's significant lack of information about choices and substitutes, or there's very high transaction costs for people to change their internet provider or change their electricity company or change their bank, if we make it hard to get information or hard to act on information, then we're not going to get an efficient outcome. And what you'll find is people end up paying higher prices and the suppliers make higher profits. You might, I don't know if you've heard the term, but we actually wrote about this years ago, the confusopoly. It's like, try shopping around for a credit card. It'll blow your mind trying to compare all the choices. The same is true for all sorts of products. So unfortunately, it's profitable to set out to confuse everybody because they'll often just give up and keep doing what they've been doing.
Or they'll pay more than they should. Some businesses, the business model is to try and confuse the customers. You know, mobile phone plans is another one. Try and compare mobile phone plans. They're deliberately complicated. That's the point. So that, you know, you find it difficult to get the best bargain, the best price, and you end up sticking or with what you've got or going for something that's more expensive.
We've got another question here. Matt, I'll ask this one of you, and it goes to, can we use price to throttle and control demand? Hillary Green asks, would a plastic tax payable at the source work to stop the unnecessary wrapping of food?
Yeah, look, absolutely. So taxes are a great way of modifying behavior. And I talked earlier about inelastic goods and elastic goods. And if you want to alter somebody's behavior, then sticking a tax on a relatively elastic good, that is a good where the consumers are price sensitive, will make consumers stop, well, we won't make them, but they'll because they're sensitive to price, they'll stop buying the good. And so therefore the supplier of the good, if it's a plastic tax, that is, they don't have to do it that way, they might choose to serve or present the goods in other ways, then absolutely it will change firm behavior and they'll say, well, look, I won't use as much plastic, right? I'm going to substitute that for something else, or I'll present the goods in some other ways. And so if your objective is to reduce the use of plastics, then absolutely a plastic tax can be the same way. And I mean, ultimately, that's what a carbon tax is. A carbon tax is, and why pretty much every economist think they're a great idea, is it's about changing firm behavior and changing consumer behavior. So they go, well, let's find a way where we can produce this good or consume this good, where we have less carbon emissions because it's more expensive to do it that way.
I'm going to disagree with Matt. I'm not anti a plastic tax. I'm not anti a carbon tax. But I think we get a little bit too excited as economists and politicians sometimes about tax. So last night I was out literally buying some beans. So here's some fresh off the hot off the presses market research. I was buying some beans for dinner and I felt like some beans. I didn't know how many, but, you know, kind of handful felt about right. The beans were in two sections. There was grab them and put them in your own bag beans or pre-packed beans. And I thought, oh, that's interesting. Why would anyone buy the pre-packed beans? Because then you're not in complete charge of how many beans you get. Someone else has already put them in the packet. So I thought, oh, maybe they're cheaper if they're pre-packed because, I don't know, maybe. Why else would anyone buy someone else's optimal amount of beans? Anyway, the beans in the plastic were $10 a kilo and the beans I bought were $3 a kilo. So I don't know that sort of a plastic tax is going to have a big impact on, I'm not opposed to one, right? Absolutely not. But it seems that there are people that like buying corn that is stripped of its natural package and then wrapped in a plastic package. And the people making billions of dollars a year selling fruit are clearly aware that there's this demand for plastic wrapped veggies. So I bought beans at a third of the price in exactly the combination I wanted by eschewing a bit of plastic. I'm not opposed to putting a tax on plastic. I'm not opposed to putting a tax on carbon dioxide pollution, but it's not obvious that that's always going to have as big an effect as we think it might. I'm not opposed, but there are often more direct routes to victory.
So there are some limitations on elasticity, you're saying, and probably down to rational actors and informed consumers.
double gold stars for you, Noah. Two bits of econobabble in one answer. Exactly. So the elasticity of demand for stuff wrapped in plastic is probably pretty steep. That is, inelastic means insensitive. Elastic means sensitive. So the 1 or 2 cents that the price would go up would likely have no impact on demand whatsoever, would be my guess. I'd rather collect the 1 or 2 cents, like I'm not anti it. In fact, the fact that it won't change anyone's behavior, some economists would say, oh, it's a good thing to tax then.
On elasticity as well, Matt, David asks, is housing more like a banana or insulin?
Only at the Australia Institute are such questions asked.
Yeah. That is a really good question. Look, housing, and you don't have to necessarily buy your housing, you rent your housing, but housing is a highly inelastic good in the sense that you need somewhere to stay, you need somewhere to live. You can be homeless, but you know there are a lot of negative consequences with being homeless, obviously. And so people desperately try and avoid it. And when you have a good that people need, okay, and they can't find substitutes for, then they're very inelastic. And the other reason I know they're very inelastic is over the last 20 years, they have raced ahead of incomes. That is, housing, the price of housing has grown far faster than the price of income. And that can only really happen for inelastic goods. If it was an elastic goods, if customers were very price sensitive, when the price started running away from income or just increasing dramatically, then people would simply stop buying it. So housing is very, very inelastic. To make it even more complicated, the housing demand for housing doesn't follow a standard demand curve at all. So if we think about housing, if there's a housing boom, right, and the price starts increasing dramatically, what do you think people do? Well, they think that housing prices are going to continue to rise. So what do? They buy more of it. So the price is going up and we're buying more of it, which is the exact opposite of what the law of demand says we should be doing. But it's an investment good and people become over-enthusiastic about investing in particularly residential property in Australia. So demand in the property market is particularly strange and particularly bizarre and it can take on some really weird turns when it wants to and has in the past.
So more insulin than banana is what Matt's saying.
Well, yeah, to answer the question, yes, far more insulin than banana.
Good. I think that sounds like a far more reasonable way to run a society. Good stuff. Richard, question from DG. They've asked, I'm interested in the economics of fines. Why are fines levied at the price that they are when they don't reflect the person's ability to pay? Talking there about income contingent fines, does that interact with the world of supply and demand at all? Is there a demand for being able to break the law?
Oh, look, great question. And yes, the Australia Institute's published 2 papers in the last 20 years on income contingent fines, which simply means setting the fine at a proportion of someone's income. And there are Nordic countries that have exactly such an approach. Look, it's a great question for a number of reasons. One is because it touches on what's fair. So if we're selling this phone for, I don't know, $600, if I earn $200,000 a year and you earn $20,000 a year, this phone's cheap for me and dear for you. Is that fair? The way we've set society up, we don't talk about, I don't walk into a shop and pay a percentage of an income, I pay dollars. So high income earners pay a smaller percentage of their income for everything than low income earners do. So as a society, if we want to put a price on speeding past a school, there's two quite different ways of thinking about it. Are we trying to say the fair price to pay for speeding past a school is $400? And, you know, just like $400 is the price of a night in an expensive hotel, or $400 is the price of a cheap phone, $400 is the price of speeding past a school, cough up, you know. The other is the purpose of the fine is to make people really stop and think. The purpose of the fine is to change someone's behavior. And if the purpose of the fine is to change behavior, then if you know that a $200 fine or a $400 fine will have no impact on some people's behavior, then it makes perfect sense to have an income contingent fine. So, you know, all an economist can do is put these options in front of you, as Matt was saying before. Different people coming from different points of view are going to argue about what's the point of a fine and what's fair. And to take a weird tangent, we were talking before about something, and I maybe about taxes and, you know, and what's fair. And, oh, it was the morality stuff. We tell ourselves stories about using price to give people an incentive, all right, or a fine to give people a disincentive. Well, if we want to give people a disincentive to do something, if we know that whipping people is a disincentive, should we consider it? Is that an economic question or a moral question? If we know the death penalty can act as an incentive or a disincentive, should we use it? Should economists answer questions like what's the best incentive effect, whipping or fines? Or would we just like to step in as a bunch of humans and citizens and say, settle down there, economists. You know, we're not really interested in your, you know, your elasticity of whipping versus your elasticity of fine. So all of these questions have moral dimensions, all of them, all the time. All we can do in economics is put options in front of you. But using a fine as a price for doing something is different from using a fine to change people's behavior. And different people come up with different notions of the role of a fair and the role of a fine.
And on the morality of things, I think we've got time for one last quick question. And it comes from Arna Greta Hunter. I'll start with you, Matt, on this one. They ask, happiness, does that come into models of supply and demand? I know you've done some work recently, Matt, looking at tax and happiness. Maybe you can tell us a bit about that. And do economists take happiness into account with these things?
No, economists are entirely uninterested with happiness. In fact, as we talked earlier about the equilibrium price, nobody's ever happy in economics. And I mean, it's called the dismal science for a reason. We just assume that everybody's unhappy and that hopefully some people are a little bit less unhappy than they were before.
The system works. Fantastic.
Yeah, exactly right. But look, yeah, you're right. We did some research recently about tax and well-being more generally, and included in that was happiness. And we were basically trying to test the theory that's often run, particularly by the current government, that tax is a drag on the economy, that tax is a wet blanket on the economy, that tax basically slows the economy down and makes us all worse off. And so what I did was is I took all the countries I could get data on, it's about 180 odd countries around the world, and I looked at their tax to GDP ratio, that is the proportion of tax they paid as the size of their economy, and then various measures of well-being, things like average income, happiness, life expectancy, and various combinations like the Human Development Index put out by the UN. And what we actually found was that the two were actually positively correlated. That is, high tax countries were more likely to have higher levels of average income, higher levels of happiness, were more likely to live longer. Now, that's not to say that there's a causal link between them, but we were testing whether or not that higher levels of taxation drag the economy down. And clearly, if average income is higher for countries, is more likely to be higher with higher tax countries, then clearly taxation isn't dragging the economy down. It isn't slowing it down. And happiness was another one. And in particular, the Nordic countries, some of the highest taxing countries in the world, also have the happiest people in the world.
Wow, what a positive note to end it on. We will have to wrap it up there as we are approaching the finishing time. But thank you so much, Richard and Matt, for being with us today. Thank you to everyone in the audience and for your great questions. As always, I'm sorry we weren't able to get to all of them, but there were some great ones in there. Please join us again over the next few weeks for our upcoming webinars, where Ebony will be back here in the hosting chair. We'll have another Economics Academy in a fortnight's time where we'll be looking at when markets work well. So we can all look forward to a thrilling 6 or 7 minute conversation there, I'm sure. So keep an eye on your inbox for your homework and for your video viewing for that session. Now, Thursday of next week, on the 5th of November, we'll be hosting a discussion on what the US election result means for climate policy. Being next Thursday, we should have a result by then out of the American election. And of course, the ramifications of the outcome for global climate policy will be huge, so don't miss that one. And the following Wednesday, the 11th of November, we'll be discussing how childcare reforms could help power the economic recovery with Jay Weatherall and Kate Carnell. You can sign up to all of those webinars at tai.org.au/webinars. Make sure you're subscribed to our podcast, Follow the Money. You can subscribe on iTunes or wherever you normally listen to podcasts. And finally, as we like to say, please stay safe out there, everyone. Keep your distance, wash those hands, and look after one another. Thanks again, and we'll see you next week.
See you later.
Thanks. Bye.